Christian Audio presents The Scars That Have Shaped Me, How God Meets Us in Suffering, written and read by Vaneetha Rendall Risner. To Shalini, without you, not a chapter in this book would exist. For you have pointed me to Christ in the darkest days, encouraged me to record God's love and faithfulness, and edited every word I've written. Foreword by Johnny Erickson Tata. Before you begin, most people think that living with quadriplegia would be utterly overwhelming. And they're right, it is. Shortly after I broke my neck, I met a young man in rehab who told me he had been in a wheelchair for 8 years. I gulped, pushing down the panic in my throat. To me, 8 weeks of paralysis seemed impossible. But 8 years? It was unimaginable to me, a spinal cord injured teenager who still retched at the thought of living life sitting down. But that was decades ago. I can hardly believe I've been living without use of my hands or legs for almost 50 years. I still look back and wonder, how did I make it to this point? And how have I done it, for the most part, with a smile? Even after all this time, total paralysis still seems impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And whenever I try to explain how I've arrived at this point, I shake my head in amazement. It has everything to do with God and His grace that sustains, not just over the long haul, but grace given in tiny moments, like stepping stones leading you from one tick of the clock to the next. And the beauty of God's grace is that it squeezes those hard moments together, eclipsing the years until one day you look over your shoulder and all you see is 5 decades of God at work. Try as you may, you cannot recall the horror of it all. Grace softens the edges of past pains, choosing only the highlights of eternal importance. What you are left with is peace that's profound, joy that's unshakable, and faith that is ironclad. It is the hard but beautiful stuff of which God makes your life. Like, when did that happen? I cannot say, but I praise God for His amazing grace. Vaneetha Risner would say the same. Here is a woman who understands deep suffering with its sorrows and joys. Perhaps that's why I consider her such a close friend. She gets it. She resonates with people in pain. And she offers a special kind of wisdom to the listener in The Scars That Have Shaped Me. The book you are listening to is nothing short of remarkable. With each chapter, my friend tenderly turns over the stepping stones of her own journey through suffering, helping us understand the hard but beautiful stuff in our own lives, how God meets us in our suffering, and how we are changed forever in it and through it. One more thing. Vaneetha and I both recognize that vulnerability is so necessary in communicating a powerful story. But we also recognize that our testimonies won't really reach or even change the life of the listener. Only the Word of God can do that. And The Scars That Have Shaped Me is overflowing with snippets of Psalms, slices of Scripture, and stories from the Bible that tell the story of God and His purposes in our pain. Vaneetha reminds us that God's reasons are perfect and that our Savior, intimately acquainted with grief and suffering, is constantly pleading our case before heaven's throne. What could be more comforting than that? And so I am honored to write this opening statement for her book. For we both know that suffering is a strange, dark companion, but a companion nonetheless. It's an unwelcome visitor, but still a visitor. Affliction is a bruising of a blessing, but it is a blessing from the hand of God. It is how God meets us in our suffering. I pray that The Scars That Have Shaped Me will inspire and refresh your heart, especially if you are in the midst of hardships or heartaches. So get started, keep listening, and be blessed by the story of Vaneetha Risner. Before you are through, you'll be looking over your shoulder and seeing much more than pain and disappointment. You'll see the unmistakably hard but beautiful stuff God is doing in your own life. Johnny Erickson Tata. Johnny and Friends International Disability Center, Agora Hills, California. Introduction. I almost titled this book, He Makes My Griefs to Sing, because the phrase so beautifully describes what God can do in our suffering. But that could make me sound eloquent and poetic, which I am neither. And furthermore, I can't sing. Just ask anyone who had the privilege of sitting near me in church. So making my griefs to sing isn't pretty. Not because I can't carry a tune and I have no idea what pitch is, but also because the song I sing in my grief doesn't sound winsome. It's often a desperate cry for help, not a stirring hallelujah chorus. But in the end, God has taken my griefs and turned them into something beautiful. He has indeed made my griefs to sing. I am well acquainted with suffering. Many of you listening to this book are as well, and suffering has carved hollows into your soul. Some of you may have even feel abandoned by God as trials have threatened to overwhelm you. I honestly have felt that way too, both as an unbeliever and as a committed Christian. I have been tempted to turn away from him in my pain, wondering why a good God would let his children suffer. Yet the Lord has proven abundantly faithful as he has filled those hollow places with an overflowing joy. Leaning into Jesus, I have discovered that he alone is my greatest treasure, and walking with him is my greatest joy. I feel honored to publish this book with Desiring God, especially because the Lord used their ministry to transform my view of suffering. Almost 20 years ago, I heard a John Piper message on the sovereignty of God, and I was immediately convicted about how man-centered and earthly focused my view of life was. For the first time, I became aware of how God uses suffering and trials in the lives of believers for their good and his glory. Since nothing is outside of God's control, I realized that all of my experiences would deepen my eternal joy. The Lord knew that I would need this newfound perspective to sustain me, for suffering would continue to mark every decade of my life. This book was born out of that suffering. My story begins in India, where I was born to Christian parents. As an infant, I contracted polio, long after it was virtually eradicated. Because the doctor had never seen polio before, she misdiagnosed me and prescribed the wrong treatment. Within a day, I was totally paralyzed. The physicians in India offered little hope for my recovery and encouraged my parents to seek better medical care in the West. We quickly moved to London, where I had my first surgery when I was 2 years old. By the time I was 13, I had undergone 21 operations and had moved from England to Canada and finally to the United States. I lived in and out of the hospital for most of my young life and learned to walk, albeit with a pronounced limp, at age 7. Though hospital life was lonely and isolating, I felt safe and normal when I was there. At home, I enjoyed the comfort of a loving family, but was openly picked on at school. Feeling like an outcast, I wanted nothing to do with God because he had allowed all of this to happen. But when I was in high school, God met me in my bitterness, and I committed my life to him. I went out of state to college and then moved to Boston for my first job. Several years later, in graduate school, I met and married a classmate, and we soon had our first daughter, Katie. After 3 miscarriages, I was pregnant again with a son, whom we discovered would be born with a serious heart defect. Paul had a successful surgery at birth, but when he was 2 months old, he died as a result of a doctor's mistake. It was soon afterwards that I heard John Piper's sermon on God's sovereignty, which radically changed my perspective on suffering. A year later, we had another daughter, Christy, and I busied myself parenting 2 children, teaching a Bible study, and speaking on the comfort of God in the midst of loss. Several years later, I developed an inexplicable pain in my arm and was eventually diagnosed with post-polio syndrome. This disease involves increasing pain and weakness, which could potentially result in quadriplegia. The most difficult part for me is that the more I do now, the less strength I will have for the future. After years of adjusting to this new life filled with limitations, my husband decided to leave our family. Within a few weeks, he had moved to another state, and our once close-knit family collapsed. Parenting adolescent daughters amidst chaos and pain while striving to model grace proved beyond my ability. Yet it forced me to rely on Christ in ways I never had before. Although it was not my choice to divorce, we eventually did, and I was faced with trusting God for a new chapter of my life. A chapter, like others, that I didn't want to begin, but I knew would increase my dependence on God. In time, God blessed me with a wonderful new husband, Joel, whom I married in 2015. Before I met Joel, I began writing a blog in late 2013 at the prompting of several friends. Writing was a way to remind myself of God's faithfulness. I then started posting articles for other ministries, excited that God would use my words to encourage fellow sufferers. This book is a compilation of some of those writings. Though the book has a purposeful order, the individual chapters do not need to be listened to sequentially. The first section largely contains my life story. The middle section is centered on finding God in various trials. And the last section points to the blessings that God gives us in suffering. I wrote this book for anyone who's experienced loss, particularly those who are struggling now. But I found that in the middle of a storm, I cannot read or process too much at one time. As such, each chapter is brief and can stand alone. I pray that the Lord will use these words to sustain those who are suffering, illuminating the priceless treasures God gives us in the darkest of places. Part 1, Fearfully and Wonderfully Made. You formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Psalm 139, 13 through 14. The scars that have shaped me. I've long despised my scars. I've spent much of my life hiding them, keeping my legs covered as much as possible. My scars told me that I wasn't like everyone else. They told me I was unattractive, an oddity, a bit of a freak. Some people are proud of their scars. They speak of courage. They show others what they've endured. They carry with them stories of bravery and adventure. But for me, with scars covering both my legs, they were not medals to display, proclaiming my bravery. They were rather deficiencies to hide, reminding me daily of my flaws, reminding me that I was damaged. As a teenager, I desperately wanted a perfect body, hoping that a perfect body would make me feel accepted. Instead, I saw in the mirror a body deformed by polio and further marked by the 21 ensuing operations. In a world filled with images of flawlessly photoshopped models, it was a challenge to believe that my physical imperfections were beautiful. So hiding my scars was natural. That way, no one could see how imperfect I was. That way, I could look more normal. That way, I wouldn't be humiliated. My scars were simply jagged reminders of my pain. I hated going to the pool or the beach or anywhere that my legs could be seen. Even if no one openly stared, I imagined that everyone was repelled by my scars. I assumed that if they saw the real me, I wouldn't be accepted. I was convinced that my scars made me ugly. When scars speak. For a short while, a close high school friend convinced me to show my legs at the beach. She said my scars might be ugly to me, but to everyone else, they represented strength and courage. To everyone else, they revealed what I had endured just to walk. To everyone else, they were just part of what I'd been through. And for a while, I did show my bare legs, but I slowly reverted back to covering them up. It was easier that way. I went back to believing the lies I had told myself. I was more valuable if no one could see my scars. I hid my wound marks and was comfortable doing so for decades. But one day I noticed this in the Gospel of John. Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. John 20, 19b through 20. The disciples recognized Jesus when they saw his scars. And Thomas needed to feel the Lord's nail wounds to verify that the risen Savior was before him. Jesus didn't need to have his scars on his resurrected body. His body could have been perfect, unblemished, unscarred. But he chose to keep his scars so his disciples could validate his identity. And even more importantly, so that they could be assured that he had conquered death. Michael Card's song, Known by the Scars, expresses this truth so beautifully. The marks of death that God chose never to erase, the wounds of love's eternal war. When the kingdom comes with its perfected sons, he will be known by the scars. God chose not to erase these marks of death, the wounds of his love for us, so our Savior will always be known by his scars. Rather than physical imperfections, Jesus' scars are breathtakingly beautiful. They represent his love and our salvation. the places I've been healed. As I consider these truths, something stirred in me. My scars are significant and precious. I shouldn't keep hiding them. I am recognizable by them. They make me unique. They are an integral part of who I am. They show that through Christ I am a conqueror, that I have suffered and by the power of the Holy Spirit have overcome. My scars remind me that God is sufficient and that physical perfection is not our goal. A life lived to God's glory is infinitely more valuable. Scars represent more than I ever realized. They can be beautiful. The dictionary says a scar is a mark left by a healed wound. A healed wound. My scars signify healing, and even though my initial flesh wounds have healed, there is yet a deeper healing in acceptance. I started to notice scars more as I looked around. There was something captivating about people who were unafraid to be themselves, authentic, unmasked, and unashamed of the wounds that shaped them. Their vulnerability was magnetic. I was drawn to them, to learn from their self-acceptance, to hear their stories, to see their courage. I learned it is often a good thing to ask people about their scars, as long as I do it respectfully and lovingly. Asking demystifies scars and allows people to share what has shaped them, because all scars have a story. I saw that when we display our scars, we inspire others to do the same. Those of us with scars should wear them like jewels, treasured reminders of what we've endured. It's okay to show our imperfections. It's even courageous. And perhaps we'll discover the beauty in our scars. The wounds of bullying. Cripple, you're a cripple. You don't belong here. Seconds after I heard the jeers, I felt the sting of gravel hitting my back. It scattered along the path, and I heard a group of boys laughing. I looked up to see who they were, but they were hidden from view. As the pelting continued, a short, heavy-set boy stepped out of the shadows. He laughed as he imitated my pronounced limp and lightly pushed me in contempt. I tried to maintain my balance, but within seconds, I collapsed on the pavement. Immediately, the boys dispersed, and it was silent. The area was deserted. I was alone. I sat there for a minute, fighting back the tears and trying to collect my thoughts. I didn't know who had done this, and I didn't know why, but I was ashamed. Something was wrong with me. Since I couldn't get up easily without help, I waited to see if anyone would come by. Eventually, I dragged myself to a nearby rock and painstakingly hoisted myself up. Relieved that no one saw me, I picked up my books, pulled myself together, and began the short walk back to my house. I wasn't going to cry. I wasn't even going to look upset. I was going to be cheerful. Determined to block out what happened, I ignored my aching body as I trudged home. When I neared the front door, my mother ran outside, beaming, "Wow, you walked home from school without your sister for the first time. I'm so proud of you." "Yeah, me too," I said, forcing a smile. After we went inside and my mother poured me a glass of milk, I offered, "I earned a sticker today." I never told her what happened that day. I was too embarrassed. I was just 7 years old. My secret pain. Sadly, this was not an isolated incident of childhood bullying. Throughout grade school, I endured different types of bullying. Some of it subtle, some of it overt, all of it humiliating. I had never talked about any of it. I'd contracted polio as an infant in India before my vaccination date. Almost immediately afterward, we moved to the West for my medical care. I spent the majority of my young life in and out of the hospital. By age 13, I had undergone 21 operations. Since I encountered cruelty so frequently, I almost came to expect it. No one ever stood up for me. Even when I was bullied in front of others, they looked the other way. They didn't want to get involved, and I didn't expect anything different. Because I never told anyone about being harassed, I drew my own conclusions about what was happening. And over time, the power of those conclusions became magnified and deeply ingrained. I told myself that something was wrong with me. I was the outcast. I wasn't worthwhile. These insecurities became my invisible wounds. I compensated well and learned to make friends, but inside I was always angry. That anger melted when I met Jesus at age 16 after reading John 9. God showed me through Scripture that just like the man born blind, he was going to use my handicap for his glory. This revelation profoundly changed me as I saw my life through a new lens, one that was bigger than just my comfort. I rarely thought about the bullying in my childhood until years later, when a painful rejection in my adult life triggered those emotions again. Although the situation was new, the feelings of inadequacy, of not measuring up, of being unimportant, felt strangely familiar. It was as though the flesh had been ripped off my invisible wounds, leaving me bloody and raw all over again. Facing my past. My feelings surprised me. I started journaling about my life in an effort to heal and sort out my emotions. As I wrote, long-buried memories came flooding back, carrying with them all the lies I had believed. The lie that my handicap made me subpar, that I wasn't intrinsically valuable, that I was defective. I shared my story with a friend as I searched for understanding. I was hesitant at first, not sure if it would be too humiliating to tell someone. I was an adult, and bringing up the past seemed childish and pointless. Yet as my past came to the light, something started to change. The lies from my past ceased to hold the same power over me. I was not to blame for what had happened. What the bullies did and said to me wasn't really about me. It was about them. I spent time in prayer asking God to show me the truth. I needed to know who I really was. He showed me the exquisite beauty of the gospel. I saw that I am not defined by what other people have said or done to me. I am defined by who I am in Christ. Jesus alone can tell me who I am, and he tells me that I am loved, accepted, of great worth. I can see the way God has used the bullying in my life to shape me. Through those wounds, he has given me compassion, resilience, and grace. He is exchanging my ashes for beauty as he fulfills his life-changing promise to use my handicap for his glory. Is God really there? God, if you are real, please show me. He was desperate, in prison, hopeless. His life was a mess, and he figured he'd give God a chance. If God even existed, that is. So he prayed and waited and looked for signs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.